with Professor Kojekar, Dr. Peter and young friends. Thank you very much for this invitation and for this opportunity to interact with. I believe all of you have just joined the MBA program, is that right? So this is really a privilege for me to be able to share some thoughts with you. And I gave some thought as to what I would like to share with you. And I thought that, is it okay? So as an international trade and investment professional, I really thought I would share the concept with you as to what is our place in the world today, what is the place of India in the world, and therefore what is the place of each one of us. And we are at a very unique place in history. And I know that to understand this unique place in history, we need to look behind a little. I know that young people don't like history, but permit me while I just take you back a little to understand how we reached this point and where we are going to go from this point onwards, according to my perspective. So if you really look back at the time from independence to the time of 1990, when India was a closed economy, many of you may have heard, your fathers telling you that we could only get two cars in India, Fiat and Ambassador, and that probably doesn't make any sense to you. You must be thinking, what kind of a world was that? Many people in India did not have a telephone in their house. Even a telephone was considered to be a luxury. So it was a closed economy. It was almost a socialist economy. There were very few manufacturers of any kinds of products in India. And actually the government would not allow people to manufacture. And if you hear ever the interview of somebody like Rahul Bajaj, he will say how he was at one time ready to go to jail because he wanted to manufacture more scooters than what the license was. So it was very strange that Indian entrepreneurs were strangled like that. And international competition was not allowed either. So there was really no competition. And if you have no competition internally and externally, naturally the consumer has no choice. Now with all this, at that time, the agriculture, it was an agriculture predominant economy. And agriculture in 1950 made up 55% of our economy. And the economic growth at that time was about 4%. Now if you really look at that era and if you look at what was the international perception about India in that time, if you had asked, I'm just imagining, if you had asked the leading economists or the leading investors at that time, like if you had asked them, what do you think about India? The answer may have been something like, I don't think about India. It was not on the world map. So that was a position, and with that type of very low growth, with that type of socialist, almost socialist trend in the economy, by 1990 we were in a real crisis. We had a real problem with the deficit in our budget, and we had actually the foreign exchange reserves were so low that in 1991, when we had Narasimha Rao as a prime minister and Manmohan Singh as a finance minister, and it became very clear that we would have to adopt liberalization. So then the world changed and life changed in 1991 when we adopted economic liberalization. We allowed foreign companies to set up in India. We welcomed foreign investors. A lot of things happened at that time. Worldwide, people started seeing our population as being something very exciting. And we say the caged tiger was unleashed. The tiger of the Indian economy was unleashed at that time, because it's not just the economy, but it's the entrepreneurial spirit which is there among each one of us, which had not been allowed to come up till 1990. Now private enterprise began to flourish. There were many new products. There was a lot of choice for the consumer. And previously unserved populations, people who had not had access to products and services. So people who had not had access to telephones or to cars or even to decent healthcare or to luxury products, consumer products, those really became the new markets to whom people started offering products and services. All of you are born to the India which happened post that, post 1991, or at least all of you have grown up in the India which has happened post that. All of you are very familiar and comfortable with an India where there is, you know, a lot of mobile phones, lots of movie theaters, lots of different types of cars, two-wheelers, and so many other products and services. When a country of 1 billion people adopts this kind of consumerism, the excitement is there for the whole world. And in the developed economies, people saw India to be a huge opportunity. The developed economies at that time were already grappling with stagnation. Their populations had become old, and the products had reached a lot of penetration so that it wasn't possible to grow. To give you an example, in the year 2007, 7 Indians out of every 1,000 Indians owned a car, whereas 500 people out of every 1,000 people in Western Europe owned a car. So the automobile companies said, where is growth going to come from? It's going to come from India. And similarly, you can see that trend across all products and services. Which means that the world made a beaten path to India's door, bringing new products, new services, new investments, and new skills. The change, you can see also that by 2008, only 17% of our economy was coming from agriculture, which I had said earlier in 1950 was 55%. It came down to just 17%, which shows the growth in industrialization by that time. Now in 2007-8, in fact for a period of good 4-5 years, we had economic growth at 8%, 8.5%, 9%. We were only second to China, who was supposedly growing at about 10%. The Sensex at one point touched 21,000 points in 2008. And you know, I remember the heady days, the kind of optimism, the kind of terrific feeling about India. Wherever we would go at international seminars, the international people who would come to India, and I'm just to give you a feel of what that mood was, I'm just going to read out some of the quotations. So in March 2006, Prime Minister Manmohan Singh said that India will grow at 9-10% every year. The international consulting organization, PricewaterhouseCoopers, in 2007 said, from 2006 to 2011, India will be the fastest growing auto manufacturer among the world's top 20 car making countries. And a McKinsey report written in 2007, all these are now historical things, but we have seen all these in front of us. Some of the things which the McKinsey report said: income levels will almost triple. India will be the world's fifth largest consumer market by 2025. Over 291 million people will move from desperate poverty to a more sustainable life. By 2025, over 23 million Indians, which is more than the population of Australia, will be among the world's wealthiest citizens. So everywhere we were facing this great hype, this great hope. And people like us, we were facing people, everywhere we went, they would be like, oh, I need to start my business in India. India is the only growth economy. All the hope is on India. Coming to 2013, it's a very different picture. And all of you are going to be graduating into a world which is quite different. And what I'm trying to do today is to tell you that if the world has changed, we may need to change our approach. So today what's happened, the world believes that India has not lived up to its promise. And international investors and companies who are trying to do business here are reporting on the crippling corruption. And only a few days ago, only 4 days ago on Twitter, I was following Mohandas Pai. Mohandas Pai is one of the founders of Infosys. And he had two tweets which are just combined for your benefit. But he tweeted on 22nd July this month, in Singapore met many investors, most disillusioned about investing in India, shocked at extent of negativity about India. Never seen such negativity in the last 19 years. India lacks credibility. People do not trust our policies and commitment. One of the saddest days of my life. This is what Mohandas Pai has written. And I I can understand because I have seen 2007-2008 and I'm seeing today. Today when people talk about India, if they say something good about India, it's mostly because they want to be polite to you. But in their heart of hearts, many people, they feel that the promise was too much, the actual reality has not matched up to that. And if you look at what people are saying today, today Prime Minister Manmohan Singh says 6.5% growth looks difficult. And you know that ArcelorMittal, the world's top steel maker, has said it is scrapping a plant, steel plant in Odisha because of delays in acquiring land, because of the obstacles, which is the government and bureaucratic obstacles. So all this at one level makes us very sad. We were the toast of the world. Are we now a bad joke? Are we going to allow this to happen to us? In keeping all this in perspective, keeping this whole situation in perspective and the world in which you are going to go out, my first submission to you is do not fall for positive or negative hype cycles. Okay, do not fall for positive or negative hype cycles. All of you in this room, which includes all the young friends, it includes the professors and it includes myself, we are not the people who flock to this country because there is a lot of gold here or a lot of diamonds here. We do not run away from this country because the gold is just dust. We are here to build this country. Keep that in mind. Keep that in mind that we are not here just to say, oh, today India is the growth story. Let's make the most of it. Let's make hay while the sun shines. We are here to build this country. And it doesn't matter to us what people say. We have to think about that. Today they say India is the greatest thing. Tomorrow they say India is the worst thing. We have to keep ourselves focused beyond that. So don't fall for the big hype cycles is my first submission to you. My next submission to you is let's shift our focus away from economic indicators. Because the other side of the story is that while our economy was growing, even at 9%, we are not doing well in the development indices, in the human development indices. And if you look at the 2013 UN Human Development Report, we see a very, very sad story. The story is much sadder than 6.5% growth or even 4% growth. It's shocking. It's shocking that the life expectancy of a newborn child in India is lower than a child born in war-torn Iraq. Okay, think about that. Overall, in the Human Development Report, we are 136 out of 186 countries, so we are still very much on the lower side. Our neighbors, which is Sri Lanka, Bangladesh, Nepal, Pakistan, are doing better than us in many, many indices. And this is shocking because India is the thought leader. India has all the technology, all the education. So the social development indices are telling us a very different story. Situation of education, health, gender equality, all are very alarming. Well, I'm sorry if I painted a gloomy picture, but that is not my intention. I'm a die-hard optimist. And I still believe that this country has a great future which is going to be written by all of you. And that's why I'm here today to share these few moments with you. We need to think differently. We definitely need to think differently. And you need to think differently even from the people who really benefited when the economy was up in 2008-2009. You need to think differently even from the Infosys and Wipros of the world. They did a great job, but you need to do something very different. So here is another submission to you. Start worrying about getting a job in an MNC. Start thinking about our development index. There are going to be opportunities in correcting those wrongs, whether it's in health, whether it's in education, whether it's in gender equality. There are going to be opportunities to do things which have a real huge impact, and the money will come along the way. Start thinking on those lines. For example, if you look at the Uttarakhand tragedy, you know, right now we are saying 6,000 people died in Uttarakhand. We still don't know the correct number. But worldwide, such a thing would not have happened because of the weather forecasting systems which are in place. Where was the analysis of the satellite data? Where were the warning systems that this much of rain is going to come? Does that mean that all our technology is only meant for earning dollars? Does that mean that all our great IT and our technology will only be used for creating IT systems for foreign customers? We will only do it if some foreign customer is paying dollars for it. We will not do it to improve the lives or save the lives of our own people. So your generation is going to be the one that will bring the change. Start thinking about solutions to these problems: education, sanitation, health, infrastructure. How can you showcase your intellectual capital? How can you show the strength of your country? Unless you are doing these things which have a real impact, how long will we just say, oh, we employ 50,000 people who make software for the world? That is not going to be the model for tomorrow. Can you link up and network and find solutions? And I want to give you some hints. The world is looking to your generation for these solutions. And there are a number of organizations today who are saying that if you have these ideas, if you have this innovation, we are ready to recognize you, we are ready to reward you. You may have heard there is the Mahindra Rise program. There is a program run by Stanford University. My organization, UK Trade and Investment, we are running the Graduate Entrepreneur program. Everywhere there are many opportunities, there are many awards, there are many scholarships. There are many people who are saying, come with the solutions. We are ready to give you support. So start scanning for those opportunities. I would like your class next time to be putting in a solution to the Mahindra Rise Award or to some of these important global awards, where Bill Gates says, you know, I am ready to put funding. Find me a solution for sanitation. Find me a solution for women's health. So we need to start thinking along those lines. Okay? Start networking and linking up with other people who have innovation, who have ideas, who have expertise. Measure the problem and brainstorm the solutions. When you have a project to do in college, you should go to a company and you should ask for a project. But sometimes if the project doesn't happen, don't do something meaningless because you have to do a project. First of all, don't do a project just for the sake of doing a project, because that is a great opportunity. It's an opportunity for you to do something. It's an opportunity for you to get inputs from our professors. So use those opportunities to think along the lines which I'm suggesting. Start finding the solutions that will benefit Indians. We can no longer be comfortable just serving as highly paid employees or outsourcing vendors for the developed countries. And my last statement to all of you is, we will have to get out of our comfort zone. That's all I have to say. Thank you.